Well, thank you guys for being here this morning. I know this is something that Bishop had asked that get done.
Welcome, so that, Deacon Chuck. Sorry.
Deacon, how are you? To make sure that all of us were on the same page with the new translation of the rite of matrimony. So back on September 9th, the new rite was open for use here in the United States. It must be used starting on December 30th, the Feast of the Holy Family. And so it's important that if you haven't gone through the rite yet and read through the rubrics and the praenotanda, the introductory notes, that you do so and do so with your deacons and anyone else who's involved in marriage preparation. There are a few changes that have been made, but not glaring changes. And so what we're going to do today is kind of go through what are the differences between the original rite of marriage that came out just after the council and then the subsequent revisions that have been made that will go into effect. So what we'll cover today, very briefly, because I don't want to keep you guys too long, is we'll go through the introductory notes, the praenotanda, and then we'll talk about the order of celebrating matrimony in the three different versions that are in the new rite. There's one for within Mass, one outside of Mass, and then the special circumstance of a Catholic who is marrying either a catechumen or a non-Christian, and what certain prayers should be used for that. We'll gloss through the various texts to be used in the rite of marriage, and then talk a little bit about the appendices that have been added to this new edition of the rite of matrimony, particularly the order of blessing for an engaged couple and the order of blessing for a married couple within Mass on the anniversary of a marriage. Then we'll briefly talk about what we talked about at our last priest meeting in October, of what we'll start doing here in the city and what we need to start getting organized as far as a comprehensive marriage preparation plan for the road system parishes, at least the ones here in town, so that we're all on the same page and regardless of where people may go for their marriage preparation, we're all telling them the same thing. And then finally, I asked Barb the other day if she wouldn't mind being here with us just to review the canonical paperwork that's required for marriage preparation, the M1 through 4 forms, and also to give us just a reintroduction to the lack of form and annulment paperwork that we have, especially since some of the changes that Mitis Iudex brought to the formal case process. So any questions so far? Good. So the praenotanda in the new order of celebrating matrimony has been greatly expanded since the first version came out in 1969. It's gone from 18 to 44 paragraphs. And one of the reasons for that is to give us, in the rite itself, a better theology of the rite of marriage, and to give us some pointers on what we should be doing as far as the marriage preparation for our people. What's interesting is that the praenotanda was completed and was going through its various translations long before Amoris Laetitia was published by the Holy Father. But you'll see if you read through the praenotanda that there are a lot of similarities, particularly when he talks about marriage preparation at different stages of a person's life, whether it's beginning with our children in religious education or within the home, whether it's working with young people who are getting to that stage of life where they're discerning their vocation more completely, the proximate preparation that we do with a couple who's engaged, and then ongoing formation that should be done. And so it's well worth the read, especially if you haven't read Amoris Laetitia in its entirety. This at least gives a good overview of what you would see in there. And so what you can see from the table is the different headers within the introductory paragraphs itself. And just sort of a comparison, for instance, the first section on the importance and dignity of marriage was expanded from 7 paragraphs to 11. The duties and ministries involved in preparation for marriage and ongoing formation actually went up considerably in the first one. In 1969, there were no paragraphs talking about duties and ministries, and then it jumped up to 2 in a minor revision, and now it's up to 16. And so it gives a really good understanding of how are priests involved, how are deacons involved, how are our laity within the parish involved, not just in the proximate preparation for marriage, but throughout a lifetime and within the community itself. The rites to be used have changed slightly, as have some of the rules as far as the preparation for local rituals and things like that. So we'll gloss over these last two very, very briefly. The local adaptations and the right to prepare a completely new rite really don't have much of a bearing on us as priests at the parish level, because most of those things are involved at the conference level. And so just give some guidelines on that. So in the first section on the importance and dignity of marriage, those first paragraphs talk about, you know, where does matrimony derive its force and its strength, how it is related to the new covenant that Jesus Christ established with us. It gets into specifically that marriage is supposed to be full, faithful, and fruitful, something that seems to be lost in our culture. That valid marriage between the baptized is always considered a sacrament, and a marriage between an unbaptized and a Catholic is considered to be valid, but not sacramental. Talks about the Trinitarian nature of the marriage covenant and how the couple is meant to image that in their own relationship with each other, with their children, and with the world. And then how God continues to call them and bestow upon them special graces within marriage so that they can continue to be of one flesh and one spirit. Any questions about that? The duties and ministries, like I said, is one that was very expanded in this current edition that is now coming into force. Talks about the role and responsibility of bishops and priests in particular, but also the community in general in assisting a couple in marriage preparation. So in those first couple of paragraphs, the fact that it's the bishop's responsibility ultimately within a diocese to make sure that there is a marriage preparation program and guidelines that are set up to be used in all of the parishes. The responsibility that priests who are pastors of souls are to make sure that their couples who are preparing for marriage are receiving that, but also drawing on the experience of the married couples that are already in our parishes, that we're not supposed to be doing this alone, that this is a community event, this is a community responsibility. And so it spells that out very specifically in those paragraphs. I pulled out paragraph 15 specifically because it talks about sufficient time for preparation of engaged couples. And it doesn't use these words specifically, but it's something that all of us should be familiar with from our marriage courses in the seminary, of remote, proximate, immediate, and continuing preparation. And it's something that if you look at paragraphs 199 through 222 in Amoris Laetitia, it's something that the Holy Father really draws out. Remote preparation being, what are we doing with our children? What are we doing with our families? To help our young people especially understand what is the sacrament of marriage? How do we understand matrimony as a church, as a people of faith? This should be done in our religious education classes, in our Catholic schools, our youth programs, and there should be help and materials provided to families at various times throughout the year to help them at home to have a solid reflection of what that sacrament is. And so starting very much at birth and helping them along the way. The proximate preparation would be for those couples and those individuals who are at that stage in life where they're beginning to discern, where is God calling me? Is he calling me to married life? Is he calling me to the priesthood of religious life? Is he calling me to the lay single life? What does good Christian dating look like? As opposed to what the culture offers us as, preparation for marriage. So how are we supporting our young people? Things like the Theology on Tap or the Feast in Faith programs that we offer in our diocese, or the different work that we do in the parish, even our preaching when appropriate, when the Wedding Feast of Cana comes up. For instance, in our cycle of readings, are we expounding on what is a Catholic understanding of marriage? The immediate preparation is something that we're all very familiar with, because that is what most of us get hit with. The couples who are dating, who have become engaged, come to us after having picked the dress and the tux and the cake and the caterer and the venue for the party. Oh yeah, we need a priest or a deacon. And so this is probably one of the more difficult stages and something that we really need to do a better job on in our focus, but it's intimately connected to the remote and proximate preparation. How do we work with a couple that's already made the decision to get married, but maybe doesn't have a proper understanding of marriage, that they have a very secularized version of marriage? And this becomes even more important given the breakdown of the family, with a divorce rate of over 50% in this country, and I believe it's even higher here in Alaska. How do we help couples to understand full, faithful, fruitful forever if they come from broken homes or homes where maybe marriage was never seen? And I'm sure all of us have stories of marriage preparation here in Alaska where we've run into couples that their parents were never married, period. They just lived together for their whole life. And so how do we fight some of those influences from the culture or from family circumstances? And then something that we probably have not done the best job in is that continuing education and that continuing formation. What are we doing to support couples after their wedding day? How are we helping them to live out those vows that they made for the rest of their lives? Are we doing marriage encounter weekends? Are we gathering our married couples together in our parishes so that they can spend time with each other, learning from each other? What do we have for couples who are in crisis? Things like retrovi, which has become very, very important in the last 20 or 30 years. With the breakdown of the family. How can we continue to develop those programs, but develop those relationships with our couples so that they can be faithful witnesses to what the church teaches? And that ties in with the next couple of paragraphs on the proper catechesis on marriage, the family, and the rite of marriage itself. What does it mean to enter into this relationship as husband and wife? What does it mean to have to be open to life and to raise children fruitfully and faithfully within the church? And why do we have the rite of marriage that we have? Why do we follow this particular celebration? And again, all of us have been, I'm sure, at one point or another at weddings, either in other churches or denominations, or even in secular, have been to secular ceremonies. And I know the comment I get a lot, especially working with like my firefighters, is, my gosh, you Catholics, it's such a long ceremony. You go to a secular one and usually it's 5 or 10 minutes, in a pretty setting with mountains in the background or something. And then they come to a Catholic church for a wedding and our mass goes on for, 45 minutes or an hour. So helping people to understand why, what is the context of the rite and why do we celebrate marriage the way that we do. The importance of the sacrament of confirmation and the sacrament of penance. They're talked about in the older forms of the rite, but the paragraph there really talks about, are we doing enough to make sure that our couples who are Catholic and who are entering into marriage have received full initiation into the church? Now, confirmation is desired, but not required for a valid marriage. But are we developing a strong enough relationship before marriage preparation even begins to know whether or not our young people who are getting married have received all of the sacraments. And then an encouragement as they prepare for the sacrament of matrimony during the process of marriage preparation over the 6 months that we spend with them, but definitely as they come up on the day of their marriage, are we giving them opportunities regularly to avail themselves of the sacrament of reconciliation so that they can enter into this new sacrament in a state of grace, open to all of the graces that God will give them in that sacrament? And I can say for myself, I've not necessarily been the best at offering that to the couple or their wedding party before the Mass to make sure that that happens. Making sure that nothing stands in the way of a valid and licit celebration of the liturgy. And that's something that the marriage preparation process should be helping us with if we're doing it the way we're supposed to. And utilizing the forms and the different premarital investigations that we do have in preparing for marriage. And that's one of the reasons I asked Barb to be here, because there are certain forms that we as priests and deacons have not been using correctly, especially when it comes to certain dispensations that are needed. Where do they need to be filed? Who can grant those dispensations? And things like that. And so she's going to give us a brief overview on that. It also talks about in these paragraphs of 19 through 22, what do we do with couples who, quite frankly, fight us tooth and nail about the theology of marriage? How are we dealing with them? Are we just sort of giving them a pass and marrying them anyway? Or are we holding their feet to the fire to help them understand what the sacrament of marriage really is? And it actually talks about in those paragraphs at one point of you may encounter people who are coming to you for marriage preparation who do not have a Catholic understanding, refuse to have a Catholic understanding, and we are not to marry them in the church. And so I found that very interesting reading through the Praenotanda that it would be that specific in saying that. It talks about ideally the priest who prepares the couple should be the one that gives the homily, receives consent, and celebrates the Mass. That would go for our deacons as well in that preparation. Again, it's not a requirement, but the presupposition of that paragraph is that if we've been working with the couple, then we're getting to know them personally. And we're able to personalize the homily, the liturgy, to the specific needs of that couple in the work that we do. And so, you know, not kind of turfing them off on someone else and then stepping in at the last minute to do the wedding itself. And then finally, it gets into 24 through 27, celebration of marriage by deacons and others. It talks about, you know, what is the role of the deacon in the celebration of matrimony within Mass or outside of Mass. It even gives specific direction for when is it appropriate for a layperson to be the witness for the church in marriage. Something that, you know, probably up here in our villages is something we need to look more into as far as having some policies and procedures in place in the likelihood that needs to happen so that we can encourage the sacrament, especially in our villages where we don't have deacons or priests on a regular basis. Any questions about the duties and ministries?
I was just reading over here in 21 and it's talking about, you know, not celebrating the sacrament with someone who rejects what the church teaches about it, and it says, this is talking about the pastor, though reluctant, he must take note of the situation and convince those involved that in these circumstances, it is not the church, but they themselves who prevent the celebration of the sacrament.
Correct. Yeah. And so, as I've sort of been researching the Praenotanda, as I've been praying over it, looking at the canons that it talks about, and reading some of the commentaries on that, There's a challenge in both directions. Okay, we need to help the couple understand that they're the ones rejecting what the church has always taught, and that they're the ones that need to take this into prayer and contemplation for a change of heart and mind. But I also read into this that we as pastors of souls need to be very careful about not rejecting people out of hand as well. That, you know, like everyone, we're like water. We tend to go and take the path of least resistance. And when a couple doesn't want to learn about the proper teachings on theology on marriage, what do we have a tendency to do? Well, I'm just not going to work with you. All we're doing is we're creating more dissension within the church, more rejection of the church by doing that. And we need to work harder to enter into a deeper relationship with those couples and deal with some of the blowback that we might get in order to help them come around. And I hope that all of us have had the experience of being with couples like that and having a positive outcome, where when you spend the time working with them, arguing with them, having conversation with them, that when they do come around, it's sort of that aha moment for them, and they live that sacrament more deeply. So really it's getting at not doing a superficial job in our catechesis, and really meeting people where they're at and having that encounter with them. Because we're fighting a lot of things, especially in this country when it comes to the secular understanding of marriage. And we need to be a lot more forthright and strong in teaching what the church teaches, but doing it in a way that's going to draw people in instead of pushing them away.
Another question. Paragraph 15 says about those different stages of preparation. And the first stage, remote, presupposes that the catechetical materials that we use contain enough information and resources for the catechists to use to engage in that type of preparation. Mm-hmm. Do the bishops intend to look again at the catechetical materials that we use? They contain such information. Mm-hmm.
I can't answer that for the bishops. They're constantly reviewing materials. Whether they're looking at it specifically, I would say possibly. This past week, the USCCB set out their three-year agenda, kind of, you know, their focus for the conference itself. And marriage and family is I think number two on the list of things that they really want to focus on. And so I would hope that we would start doing that. But at the same time, it's not just the responsibility of the bishops' conference or even the local bishop to do that. It's our responsibility as well. And there are a lot of materials out there. Some of the materials that we'll start using, at least for the immediate preparation, are things like, you know, the Beloved series from Augustine Institute. Their video series is a solid series. CatholicMarriagePrep.com, which is an online marriage preparation program, is a solid program, and it's not something that you know, somebody sits at a computer and clicks away and then we marry them, but they're actually interacting with a sponsor couple who's working with them. They're looking at adapting, you know, through the Augustine Institute, through Ascension Press, some of the catechetical materials that they've now developed for adults, like Beloved, and bringing them down to levels that our teenagers can understand or our young people can understand. And they're doing that with all the sacraments. There's a baptism prep now through Augustine Institute. There's a reconciliation program that they're slowly revealing, which unfortunately won't come out in its totality until, I believe, Divine Mercy Sunday of this coming year. But all of these things are coming out. And I think if we have good staffs working with us as well, that we can take that information and boil it down to a level that our children are going to understand. And, you know, someone like Kayla out in your parish, Father Stan, has done that before. In fact, she has found that with our teenagers, they do better with the materials that are labeled for adults than they do with the teen materials. In fact, our kids in St. Nick's and Immaculate Conception have complained that some of the teen materials are too watered down, and they're looking for something deeper and more solid. So I don't see why you can't experiment with some of those things as well, and then encourage families as well to get together in small groups to do their own catechesis. So in the celebration of matrimony, there's a focus on the communitarian character that encourages the participation of the community. And when you look at the prenotanda, when you look at the rubrics within the different celebrations, what you see is the church calling us to make sure that in everything that we do, that the community is involved. Are they doing the readings? Are they helping as extraordinary ministers of Holy Communion? Are we using songs and hymns approved by the church that can be sung by the people instead of just using instrumental music as so often is the case in marriage? And as we do so, are we also drawing the couple into the preparation of the literature? I think every priest develops their own method for how the liturgy is put together. I know for myself, I've basically said to the couple, everything that you are using for your liturgy is up to you. Pick the readings, pick the prayers, and then I think really the only thing that I tell them that they that I have control over is which Eucharistic prayer I use, and then I've never allowed my couples to do the exchange of consent by questioning. I always make them recite their vows, even if it's repeated after me. But I know other deacons or priests who have said, I get control over the gospel reading, or I get control over this part. Involve them as much as you can. I'm not going to tell you how to minister to your people, but I think the prenotanda would suggest that the more you involve them in all aspects of the liturgical preparation, the better, because you're getting them to enter into it more fully and completely as you go through that. And some of the products that are out there will help with that. Father Ross has there on the table the Together for Life, which is a book that I think many of us are using in our parishes, and it's been updated with the new rite. And for each of the readings, it gives a short theology and catechesis for the couples. And so encouraging them to, spend even several months, daily, read one of the readings, read the commentary on it, pray over it as a couple. But also making sure that the couple is involved. So often you have one individual who is doing all the work on the liturgy, tends to be the bride. Get both of them involved and be pointed with them as well, especially if it seems like one of them is less involved than the other. Father Caspar, what do you think about using the wedding feast at Cana as your gospel reading? And elicit that discussion and that reflection. It talks about the festive nature of the liturgy, but also keeping in mind the character of the season. This has never changed. No marriages are permitted on Good Friday or Holy Saturday. But there are certain days of the year where the ritual mass, the rite of matrimony, cannot be used, okay? Where the readings of the day must be used, typically with solemnities, or on certain Sundays of the year, like during Advent and Lent. Now, I get a chuckle out of that when I read that, because I don't know what sane pastor would do a marriage, a wedding on a Sunday, given how full our schedules are, but it's something to keep in mind. But as we do that as well, knowing that we have couples that get married at various times of the year, if we're in the season of Advent or the season of Lent, are they toning down the celebration to keep in mind the season that we're in? Or are they having a coronation in the middle of a penitential season? And so working with them to understand that. And the ritual masses when you can't use the ritual mass, if you look in the universal norms of the liturgical year, which is in the front of the Roman Missal, that will give you a list of all of the days that you have to use the Mass of the day. And it's important for your people to understand that, because they don't have a sense sometimes of the importance of progressive solemnity and the importance of certain feast days and solemnities that we celebrate in the church. Make sense? The particulars on the celebration of the rite, 33-38, really talk about, what are we, what's involved in the rite itself. The readings, the gospel acclamations, the music, the prayers, those sorts of things. And then 37 focuses us on the homily in particular. What are we doing about the pastoral care of those who will be attending the wedding, who rarely, if at all, go to Mass and celebrate the Eucharist, or who rarely, if at all, are part of a sacramental celebration of marriage? Are we helping them to understand more deeply why the Church does what she does and why this celebration is so important, not just for the couple or the family, but for the Church as a whole? Now, there are a couple adaptations that have been made. So 39 through 44 details which adaptations can be made to the universal norms and adapted from the Roman ritual to take into account particular customs. What you'll find in the new rite, and I won't talk too much about it just because it's not as big a deal for us here as, say, in other dioceses, but they have put in a liturgy or part of the rite for the use of the lasso and the aras, the gold coins that are common when you're doing Hispanic or Filipino weddings and things like that.
Is it gold coins or just like a coin?
I've always seen gold coins, but I think they make them in silver. There's all different kinds that can be used.
They're from Chuck E. Cheese.
Yeah, I mean, I've seen plastic ones too that people have used, but they're meant to be a symbol of that care and concern that the couple has for each other and things like that.
The question I have that's not concerned to ask here much, but sort of most of our diocese deals with Native Americans, Eskimos, and Athabascans, and this rite gives a possibility to accommodate to local culture and customs. Do we have a plan to get involved in some kind of a discussion to see how can we enculturate the rite?
I think we should, and that's something that we need to bring up with the bishop. The big thing with the cultural adaptations, and this is where I think, the inclusion of the aras and the lasso is a good example for us. The reason that the church has put those in there is because, especially those of us that don't come from those particular cultures, have been left trying to figure out where does this go in the rite. With any liturgical celebration, whether it's the rite of marriage or a Sunday Mass, it's always important for us to remember the dance that we're going through and to know what the next step is before we get there. And sometimes the insertion of these cultural adaptations brings a liturgy to a screeching halt. And it just doesn't fit well. And so I think any cultural adaptations that we would do for our Alaska Native communities that, just like we've done with the Sunday celebration in the absence of a priest, that we need to have a consistent policy and a rubric in place so that things flow. And that's why, for example, it's not addressed in here, but I know in our particular policies here in the diocese, things like the use of the unity candle. I'm not seeing that as much as I used to when I was first ordained, but trying to get couples to understand that's not part of our rite in the church. In fact, it's really not part of anyone's religious celebration of marriage. It's something that, Hallmark and all these wedding companies sort of invented to add into it. And the few times that it has been used in masses or in liturgies of the word, it's always this awkward, they light the candle, they blow these two side candles out, and everyone stands there while some cheesy song is being sung, and nobody knows what they're doing. It's just very awkward. And so helping them to understand, that's part of the preparation of why the liturgy is set up the way it is. And how does this dance work so that it has a beauty and a dignity to it. And I think it's quite possible with our native cultures to do that.
We talk about inculturating the rite. We talk about inculturating the entire rite. It's not just adding some cultural elements to a rite, mm-hmm. which is not culturally fitting at a certain place.
Right.
And so that's why, you know, when you add something which is foreign to the local mentality and, mm-hmm. and customs, yeah, it disrupts the rite to some percentage. So the entire rite must be fitting in the culture.
Mm-hmm. So correct.
It's not just a particular element.
Right. But it does make it very specific, though, that depending on how enculturated it's made, it may require the consent of the bishop's conference for the United States, or it may even have to go higher than that and go over to the Holy See. So we have to be careful with that we're not, you know, changing it willy-nilly just for the sake of quote, culture. So the rite itself, I debated on what was the best way to go through this. And I know when I was down in Anchorage for the FDLC's presentation, they went through each permutation of the rite. I don't think that that's helpful. I think you guys are capable of reading the rubrics of the Mass or of celebration outside of Mass. So be aware of those three different ways of doing it. So what I want to highlight more is what's changed in the overall rite that you need to keep in mind as you move forward in the next couple of months as this takes full effect. So in the introductory rites, in the 1969 prenotanda and in the rubrics, there were details about the procession. And some of you might remember, if you read the rubrics, that up until this current translation came out, there was a desire for us to try to get the couple to process into the church together, side by side, as husband and wife, and come equally to the altar for the celebration of the sacrament. I can tell you that in my 9 years as a priest, I've had two couples do that. Usually it's, you know, you mention that to them and the bride starts talking about how she's always looked forward to her father walking her down the aisle and things like that. And so what we see is there's been a change in the details about the procession. It now says the procession is done in the, quote, customary manner. So again, there's sort of an adaptation there of the way that we would do it here in town versus the way it would be done in the village, the way it would be done in Japan, the way it would be done in India. It allows for that flexibility. So we don't have to fight some of those traditions that have kind of always been there within our culture and within the church. There's no mention in the 1969 version of a penitential act. And you'll notice that I've got 1990 and 2016. There were some minor revisions that were made in 1990 that kind of went unnoticed. And one of those was the fact that the penitential act is omitted. The 2016 rubrics make it much more clear that a penitential act is not done. So to keep that in mind. But what it has added is that a Gloria is always done regardless of the season. So even during Advent and Lent, if you're celebrating the rite of marriage within the context of the Mass, the Gloria is to be done. It also gives a sample introductory address and gives suggestions on where that should be done. In one form, it gives you the option of doing it at the doors to the church just before the procession begins. It also gives you the option of doing it as they approach the sanctuary in the procession. So it gives you that flexibility depending on how your church is set up, what you're comfortable with, what the couple is comfortable with. And I would presume that is taking into account as well the procession in the customary manner. You're not going to do the the address of the introductory address at the door to the church if the husband-to-be is at the front of the church already. So, you know, adapt it logically. Any questions about the introductory rites?
So we can begin there at the door, the father and the son, and then introduction.
No.
Processing. As they're coming to the church, then we can sing the Gloria.
No. What it has here, let me find it. Yeah, there we go. If you've got the red book, it's page 21. The first form, at the appointed time, the priest wearing an alban stole and chasuble of the color of the mass to be celebrated goes with the server to the door of the church, receives the bridal party, and warmly greets them, showing that the church shares in their joy. Second form is he goes with the server to the place prepared for the couple or to his chair. And really, this is that. Again, we all do it differently. I know when I have the couple, when the procession is finished before the music has stopped, I'm greeting them at the front. I've got the microphone turned off, and I'm sort of giving them, you know, a little bit of last-minute advice of, you know, stay calm, watch me. You know, we are all here to pray with you and to bless you on this joyous occasion. You can get out of it until you say I do. You know, those sorts of things, just to kind of put them at ease. And so it's not, where before it wasn't formalized, what we have now is something that is a lot more. It's you know, use these or similar words, and it gives you on page 22 two versions of what you can use. We've come rejoicing into the house of the Lord for this celebration, dear brothers and sisters, and now we stand with Bob and Ann on the day they intend to form a home of their own. It goes through that. You don't have to use those words, but it's basically the greeting that you would be giving to the couple and to the people. Why are we here? You know, because what some priests end up doing, even at a wedding, is they launch right into, in the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit, peace be with you, let us pray. And there's no acknowledgement of the special circumstances of the liturgy that we're celebrating. And so adding a little more solemnity to it.
Okay. I still didn't get it. These words can be used at the entrance or when we come to the altar.
Correct. Yeah. And once you do those, then there's the normal introduction to the Mass that you would have. Okay. Yeah.
So yeah, words should be used at the altar.
Or at the door.
After the procession, right?
Before or after, depending on how it's being done. Oh. If the couple is coming in together, then it might be ideal for you to greet them at the back door because you're going to be processing in with them, okay? Or if you have the groom in the front of the church already and he's waiting for his bride to come down the aisle, it would be ridiculous for you to go back there, then run to the front and greet them again, okay? So you take into take the circumstances into account of how it's being done, okay? There's an expanded number of scripture readings for the rite of matrimony. This really hasn't changed. These are the same readings that were in the 1990 version. It just makes it a little more explicit that from the 69 to the current version, we've had some masses that have been added. But one thing that has changed is it makes it clear in both the prenotanda as well as the rubrics that one of the readings must explicitly talk about marriage. And so to help you with that, I'm going to pass these around. The FDLC put together a short list of all the readings. And I don't know if the Forever for Life books have it, or Together for Life books have it. But on this paper that's coming around, there's an asterisk next to the readings that explicitly talk about marriage. So one of those with a star next to it must be used by the couple in their liturgy. And again, you know, kind of trying to understand the mind of the church and to, you know, why she would require that one of those particular readings be used is I really think it's the cultural shift that we've had in the understanding, the classical understanding of marriage. And so the church wants to draw that out more with making sure that one of those readings talks about marriage explicitly instead of just talking about love or commitment.
Mm-hmm. Is it necessary to have three readings? I always do two readings. The church ceremony, is it necessary, like Sunday Mass, three readings? First reading, song, and the gospel. Usually I do that way.
Yeah, so
he says there may be three readings.
Yeah, in number 55 in the rubrics, the liturgy of the word is celebrated in the usual manner. There may be three readings, of which the first reading should be from the Old Testament, but during Easter time from the book of Revelation. At least one reading that explicitly speaks to marriage. So
maybe.
That gives you some flexibility. I think what we need to keep in mind, though, is the rite of marriage in its totality. If the church is asking us to use a Gloria during the during the celebration of the Mass, even during Advent and Lent, it's raising the solemnity. And if it's raising the solemnity, when you think about the progressive solemnity that we have within the church, when a Gloria is added, typically there is more than just one reading. There's usually two plus the gospel. And so I would encourage a fuller celebration of the Mass like that, because you are getting Old Testament, New Testament, and Gospel all together. But there may be circumstances where you don't do that. Say, the celebration of the rite of marriage, rite of matrimony with a catechumen or a non-Christian. It would be appropriate to pare down the readings a little bit because you're dealing with not only a bride or a groom who are not catechized, but maybe half a family that's there as well. And so taking that into consideration. There's expanded list or retranslated list of the prayers. And I tried to kind of throw it all on one screen as best I could. I know it's not great to see it all this way. But the collects, there's six different versions. Prayer over the offerings has stayed the same. The preface has stayed the same. Although with these, the prayer over the offerings and the prefaces, it does make it clear, if you've read the rubrics in the Roman Missal, that if you use version one of the prayer over the offerings, you should be using preface one, because they're intimately connected. And so when you're helping your couples in the preparation of their liturgy, help them to understand that connection, that certain prayers and prefaces go together for logical reasons. There's commemoration for the couple that has always been present in Eucharistic Prayer 1 in the Roman Canon, but they've added one for Eucharistic Prayer 2 and 3 as well. And I think those are in an appendix in the back of the Roman Missal, and they're not in the prayers themselves. Under the solemn blessings, you'll notice in 1969 we had three universal solemn blessings plus one adaptation for the United States. That adaptation for the United States has been taken out. That would have been the one. So solemn blessings typically have three orations to them before the sign of the cross. The adaptation for the United States had five. So it was a lot longer. I don't know many couples who used it, but on occasion it was. That is no longer in there. And then the simple blessing is still there as well. There's also, for the invitation to the nuptial blessing and the nuptial blessing itself, in this copy of the rite, in the back, there are chant notations for the introduction to the nuptial blessing. It follows the same simple chant notation that we use for the prefaces, okay, more or less. So you know, if you do chants at Mass, it shouldn't be too difficult to learn the chants for the solemn or the nuptial blessings here. But I know some of you don't do that. Again, with that as well, you got to take in the circumstances. If you're dealing with a couple that's regularly at Mass, they're used to those sorts of things. You've got a participating group of parishioners there. great, use it. If you're dealing with, you know, a catechumen or a non-Catholic getting married to a Catholic, maybe not using it. You know your couple before you go throwing chants in different places. The address of the bride and groom and the questions before consent and the consents themselves have all stayed the same. The reception of consent, there's two versions of it now. Blessing of the rings as well. And then they've added the blessing and giving of the aras and a hymn or a canticle of praise as well. Those are optional parts of the rite that can be used. So just to keep that in mind. Now, again, with the consent, the two forms and methods that are used, take note of the fact that the translations of that have changed as well. And so when you use it, you want to make sure that they're practicing the right ones. And now this is just a personal preference of mine. As I mentioned, when I prepare a couple for their wedding ceremony, I don't allow them to do their exchange of consent by question. My preference is that they speak the words. And I encourage the couples that I work with to try to memorize their vows. You know, always have them in front of you in case they get nervous and they go screwing them up. But there's something about the couple verbalizing those words of consent, those promises they're making themselves instead of you saying them and them saying yes. It's personal preference. You know, you're going to do what you're going to do. But make sure that you keep that in mind, that the vows have changed slightly. Any questions?
I think that last form, when you ask them, those questions, and then they simply act, "I do," is more appropriate in cases where you deal with couples that may have difficulty with English.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
And so you go through the rite with them beforehand, but then during the rite, during the celebration, just to make things simpler, you may ask that question, and they respond with a simple "I do."
Well, and some cultures as well, it's more appropriate for them to simply say "I do" than to go and, you know, repeat those vows. And so taking that into consideration. Yeah.
So that acclamation thing is something that's new that probably needs to be pointed out.
The acclamation, yes, you're right. Let me find that.
The new part for the people.
That is, okay, so after the reception of consent, the acclamation, if you look on page 32, if you have the red book, or number 64 in the rubrics, the priest receives the consent in one of two forms. "May the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, the God of Jacob, the God who joined together our first parents in paradise, strengthen and bless in Christ the consent you have declared before the church, so that what God joins together, no one must put asunder." And then, you know, before people would say amen, if they knew, right? But now the priest says, "Let us bless the Lord." And the people's response is to be, "Thanks be to God." So when they're putting together their liturgy, when they're putting together the worship aid, that might be something to take note of that should be put in there specifically, especially over the next few years as we get used to this new rite. Thank you for that. Also, the universal prayers, they have them in an appendix now, which is helpful, so that you can make sure that we're following the universal norms for those prayers, instead of just sort of the buckshot approach that sometimes happens.
What's the difference between a red book and a white book?
Just who publishes it. The white book is a different company, but it's the same thing. That's why, you know, I'm referring to the page number in this, but also to the paragraph number for the rubrics, because the rubric numbers are all the same, regardless of who publishes it. You know, there's lots of different forms. I personally don't use these books, when I celebrate Mass, just because, you know, trying to find ribbons and all this kind of stuff, I usually put, you know, readings in a binder and things like that. And they do make celebrant copies of binders where you just kind of pull the appropriate readings and put them in. Yeah, in fact, Chuck, you have that, don't you?
We just received the new ones and I didn't...
Yeah, so like this one? Yet. It's the exact same thing, but so you can pull the pages out.
And that corresponds with Together for Life.
Oh, okay.
The page numbers in there, so if you want to print them, if they choose their things in there, you can just go to whatever, B7, copy it, put it in the binder.
Nice.
Makes it a lot easier.
It does. The only challenge I've found with the binders is you got to make sure your pages get back. Otherwise, you lose them.
Yeah.
So I have, like I said, I have a lot of the stuff copied or, you know, typed up on the computer already, and I just kind of pull for the liturgy. So
it would be nice. Yeah. I think I mentioned it to them, and they were considering it to just have a file or a website where you go to and print them out.
Right. Someday there will be an app for that, I'm sure. So.
Some dioceses do. If you search around on the internet, you may find somebody who's done it and posted it. But yeah, you got to search.
Right. But this time, there's nothing that's really sold. You know, there's no website you can subscribe to have all that. Some of the other changes, some of it's minor, like terminology change. The blessing and giving of rings as opposed to the exchange of rings. The posture and place of the couple for the nuptial blessing is something that is more explicit in the new rite. It calls for the couple to be kneeling. And it's important to note that because the nuptial blessing comes after the Our Father, so everyone is standing. And you know, I can't speak for, you know, what others have done, but I know for myself, I've always had the couple standing because everyone's already standing. But this now calls for them either to kneel before the altar or at another appropriate place, like where they're seated, but to be kneeling for that prayer when it takes place. The rubrics regarding the signing of the marriage record, I could not find that in the older rubrics, and I don't think it existed. But it makes it very clear that when the Mass is concluded, the witnesses and the priests sign the marriage record and the license, either doing it in the vesting room or they can do it in the presence of the people. However, it's very explicit that it is not to be done on the altar. So if it is done in the presence of the people, it should not take place front and center on the mensa.
So this is basically the signing of a civil record in the event of a couple that is being married jointly, that it's civil. But if it's a convalidation, then it would be the civil marriage would have taken place already. Mm. And what are they signing? A certificate that you create and then give to them?
It varies from place to place. There are some churches and some dioceses where the couple actually signs the marriage register itself, the sacramental record. We don't do that here, mostly because we want to be able to read everything. Not that having us fill it out is any better than having the couple sign it. But yeah, for us here, it would typically be the signing of the marriage license, the civil license, or if you have a certificate that you've got, they could do that as well. But I think the big thing to understand is it's not to be done on the altar. So.
These days, they are sending two certificates from the state when you apply for a license. License one paper and then plus with that two certificates.
Yeah, the certificates, the state sends those out for the civil marriage. I've never used them. And you know, if you're going to give them a certificate, I have a sacramental certificate that I use. Because the only reason that we do the civil paperwork is because the state allows us to be, you know, dual witnesses, one for the church and one for the state. Why would we give them a civil certificate when we would give them, you know, when we recognize it as a sacrament? Some people use it.
And they're pretty, but they don't mean anything.
Right, exactly.
You can't use them for anything. You'd have to get an official thing anyway.
Yes, exactly. And that's another big thing to remember is, you know, in the last few years, they've also changed the marriage licenses up here in the state. One, because of the change in the definition of marriage civilly, it now has spouse one and spouse two instead of man and wife or husband and wife. But they've stopped doing it in triplicate as well. It's a single sheet of paper. So you need to make sure that before the couple leaves, that you have a copy of the license paperwork to slip into the marriage folder so that it's complete. And then again, everybody handles it differently. Since technically we're the ones that witness the marriage, we're the ones that are required by the state to make sure that the license paperwork gets to the state. And so I may give a copy of that to the couple, but I take the original and I mail it off so that I know that it went out, because it's not valid until it's certified by them. Okay. The appendices that we have in the new order are very nice. There's an order of blessing for an engaged couple. We've had some form of that in the Book of Blessings, but to actually have it in this book now is very nice. It gives a short liturgy that can be done outside of Mass, either by a priest, a deacon, or a layperson. Even parents would be able to do this. And so ideally they're gathered with their loved ones either at the church or at home, and the blessing is done. The big thing about the rubrics in there is it's never to be combined with a celebration of Mass. And that's all it says. It doesn't give a reason why, but my assumption would be that the reason that they don't want it done at Mass is so that it doesn't have the appearance of the celebration of a marriage. And so be aware of that. I don't see why you couldn't do it after Mass. Just do it in a way that it's very clear that this is not the sacrament being celebrated. But it is a good way, I think, as far as the proximate and immediate preparation of a couple to acknowledge that, you know, to ask God to bless them as they enter more deeply into that preparation, final preparation to enter into the sacrament. And so I would encourage its use as often as possible with our couples. Any questions about that one? No. And then all of us have been in that situation of what do we do with married couples on their anniversary who want to have a special blessing in some way. We now have an order of a blessing of married couples within Mass on their anniversary. And it can and should be done on significant anniversaries like their 25th, their 50th, their 60th, but it can be used for any of them. One of the things that you'll note, and I know I've done this and I've watched other priests do it as well, is they do not do an exchange of consent. I know some of us have adapted the rite of marriage for those anniversary celebrations. Use the appendix, use the rite that's been given in Mass. And again, that's a good way for that long-term catechesis as well with our young people. They need to see solid marriages. They need to see couples who have been married for 25, 30, 50, 60 years. And they should be held up as not just examples, but mentors. Especially for young couples who are just entering into marriage, that maybe are dealing with the difficulties of the first 5 years of adapting to living as husband and wife. You know, how did Manning and Betty Stroop out in North Pole? How did they manage for so long? Especially when Manning started suffering from Alzheimer's. Remember blessing there. Blessing them on their anniversary, even though he wasn't capable of, renewing consent or anything like that. But it was a witness to not just the longevity of their relationship, but also their living out of the sacrament and those vows, especially in difficult times. So. And then, of course, the universal prayers are also there as well. There's two versions that can be used. And it allows for some flexibility in that.
I don't remember ever seen the blessing of rings done in a, blessing of a married couple at Mass.
Oh, yeah, we've done that. Yeah, there's a blessing of the rings, especially if they've lost rings. That's not uncommon after 50 years, or rings that don't fit, things like that. I guess the one question I would have with the blessing of rings, I'm noticing that it's becoming more and more common for couples to not have metal rings anymore. They have these like plastic and galvanized rubber rings. I think it'd be less, I would be more reluctant to bless those than I would nice rings, but church doesn't have any opinion on that, at least officially, so I leave it up to you. So, as we discussed a few weeks ago, our plan for marriage preparation in the city parishes is to have a two-track system. The first part of preparation is going to be similar for both. Common to both tracks is going to be the premarital investigation and the utilization of the M1, 2, 3, and 4 forms. So the M1 being sort of the quick contact sheet of information. The M2 is the canonical investigation. Are they free of any impediments to marriage? Those sorts of things. M3 is the request for dispensations of various types, and M4 is for disparity of cults, and what else, Barb? And the what?
Isn't it establishing certainty about freedom to marry?
Yeah, I think that's part of it as well. Yeah. Okay. Yep, so Barb is going to talk about those forms here in a minute, just so we have a correct understanding of how those should be used. And then as Bishop mentioned at the last meeting, some sort of premarital survey or inventory needs to be done with the couple. A lot of us are using the Prepare and Rich. There's also the Focus, which comes out of Creighton, I believe. And there's a couple other versions out there. Use what you're comfortable with. I prefer the Prepare. I think it's easier to use than Focus. And both of them can be done online now so that the couple can do it at their convenience. After you have done the premarital investigation and the premarital inventory, then you discuss with the couple which track is going to work best for them. Track one, which is the ideal one because it involves more interaction, is a six-week marriage preparation course utilizing the Beloved video series in a group setting with sponsor couples. I have not heard back from any of you. My request was that each parish offer up two or three couples, sponsor couples, who would be willing to help out with this, where we could have ongoing classes over six-week periods where these various couples would be subject matter experts on the different sessions. And we would have it set up so that if Father Stan had a couple in week one, they would run through the six-week series with other couples from one to six. But if Father Ross had a couple come in week three, they would be able to jump in at week three and they would just have to do the whole thing. Because the Beloved series is set up, ideally, that you watch the videos, one through six in order, but they are standalone as well. And so the advantage to that is we're involving the laity, who, quite frankly, are subject matter experts on the day-to-day of marriage anyway, because they're living the married life. But we're also encouraging interaction, not just between the sponsor couples and couples preparing for marriage, but the engaged couples as well, so that they can talk about these different things. We're only going to be using the first half of the Beloved series for this six-week course because we will require, if they do track one, mandatory attendance at an engaged encounter weekend. And the second half of the Beloved series is what's focused on in the intensive weekend on an engaged encounter weekend. And so encourage them. Most of us have access to it online in the cities now, so encourage them to watch the videos on their own, but it won't be a requirement that they do the second half but they must go through engaged encounter. If they can't do it here, they need to be looking to Anchorage, they need to be looking to Seattle, other places that have that, and we need to be firm with our couples on that. Since, you know, at a minimum, we should be doing 6 months of preparation with them anyway, there is no reason why a couple shouldn't be able to schedule time to go to one of those weekends, because we have one typically in October, and then one usually in the March-April timeframe. And then Anchorage, any idea when, if they have anything consistent down there right now, or?
Not that I know.
Okay.
Working on that.
Okay, I know there were some bumps down there.
Yes.
But hopefully it'll get that back up and running. So, track two, which would be more appropriate, say, for military couples or couples that are separated by distance, is to use marriage preparation through CatholicMarriagePrep.com. They register online. And as part of that, the Prepare and Rich is administered, and it's used by the sponsor couple that's assigned to them.
I worked with them, and they didn't use Prepare and Rich. Whatever they did with CatholicMarriagePrep.com mm-hmm. did not involve the Prepare and Rich. And I called afterwards and asked about it. And they says, no, that's like you have that common to both. At the uh-huh. parish level, you do the Prepare and Enrich, and they said that's where we have it. I think there's an
okay.
option that it can be built into it.
Yeah, see, I was under the impression that it was built into
it's
it.
Not, it's a, not automatically built into it. I learned that the hard way.
Okay, that's good to know. So make sure you're running the Prepare and Enrich or the Focus, regardless of the track. What's nice about this online course is that they are assigned with an actual sponsor couple who's working with them. It's not just something that they're doing on their own. And it's set up sort of like an extended engaged encounter weekend, you know, where they're being given reflection questions, there's homework to do, they can't just blow through it. And you can't advance to the next session through this website without having done the homework and getting having gotten feedback before moving on. Now, with that being said, they offer several different versions. There's the online pre-cana, which most of our couples would be using. So it can be completed within 3 weeks, but it must be done within 3 months at a max. So it gives them an end date that has to be done. There is an urgent care program that takes less than 3 weeks. They could theoretically get it done in 5 days. I have never used that, nor would I encourage that at all, because I think that it defeats the purpose of marriage preparation when you're blowing through that. So I honestly not sure when we would use that on a practical level in this diocese. If we're interacting with our couples, there should be more than enough time. And for those of you that have military in your parishes, they do offer a discounted rate for military couples. Basically, they need to take a picture of their military ID, cut off their social security number, and email it in, and they apply a discount. But if you do have military, have them sign up for it, not just because of the discount, but there are also aspects of the preparation program that deal with the situations that are common to our military couples, particularly deployment, issues of PTSD, or combat stress, and things like that, that couples may be dealing with. And so it's a good, solid program. I've used it half a dozen times for various couples for various reasons. In fact, all of the couples that I've used it with have suggested that this be our primary one because they thought it was so good.
Okay, I'm sure all of you, except probably Father Dominic, are familiar with the M1-4 forms. I have a bunch of extra. I wasn't anticipating how many of you were going to show up, so I know you use these regularly, so if you want to grab some at the end, please feel free to do so. The M1 form, I'll go through it briefly with you. On the left side is the groom, the right side is the bride. please fill out as much information as you can. And of course, at the bottom it says after the wedding, you want to fill that in to confirm it, because this goes in the marriage prep file. On the second back page of the M1, this is where we get into the dispensations. This is real important that you fill this out, because this can invalidate a marriage. And I want to tag on also that the M4 is also very important. It's the same thing. Now, I know I've had several of your brothers say to me, why do we have to fill out these? This is redundant. I have different dioceses that contact the tribunal office that ask about, have there been dispensations given for this couple? I go check our archives where the dispensations are filed away. There's no dispensation. I respond, there are no dispensations to be found anywhere. So I don't know where the couple was married or whatever. I go through our file to look for dispensations. So if they're doing a tribunal case, an annulment case, it's possible that they'll say, oh, they didn't receive the proper dispensation. This marriage wasn't valid to begin with. When in fact it probably was, because it's in your marriage prep file that was never sent to the chancery to be put on file. So the back of M1 is very important you fill that out. M4, very important that you send me the original and copy one for your file.
So you get the M4 original, you don't get the M1.
Correct. I never see the M1. I only get the M4 and then I put that in our archives. So if you have dispensations, remember to fill out the M4, copy it for your marriage prep file, send me the original and I'll file it in our archives. Okay? So that's why it's redundant or done twice, so that we have a record of that. And of course, filling out permissions and the delegations if necessary, if it's within the diocese. And you do have that authority to do that, to grant the delegation, with the exception of the deacons. The deacons need to receive a delegation to make it a valid marriage. Now, I know some parishes have more than one deacon, and one deacon will call the other one up and say, I can't make it, I don't feel good, can you cover for me? You can't do that. You have to receive delegation from a pastor. Okay. Any questions on the M1? Okay, M2, we have, there should be two copies. You don't have two copies, but you can make one. One's for the groom and one's for the bride. And of course, you interview them separately on that. And number one is very important that that be checked off, yes or no, that they're telling the questions most truthfully as possible. Fill out the rest of that, if there's any possible impediments. Have they been married before? That should probably be number one question when you meet with a couple. Prepare for marriage. Have you had any other marriages before? A lot of times they'll think, oh, I didn't think this one was valid because it was just in Vegas or something and only lasted a couple weeks. In the eyes of the church, it was a civil marriage, so they did have a prior marriage, and that needs to be taken care of. The back's also important to fill out, excuse me, by the signature of the party and the pastor or the deacon or whoever was helped preparing them.
What is a common law union?
That is recognized by about 7 states in the country, most of them in the Northwest here. And that is if you've lived with someone for 7 years, the state recognizes that as a common law union.
Somewhere along the line, and I don't know if it's anecdotal or correct, when I lived in the state of Oklahoma, if you lived with someone for a much shorter period than 7 months, it was considered a common law union. So is there a resource that identifies what states have a common law union and what the dates are, so that we can be specific in asking individuals who might not realize that they have a common law union by virtue of the state there where they might have cohabitated?
You can Google that. I was at a canon law conference and I did Google it and gave information.
I'm just thinking you as a diocesan resource could provide for uniform guide for everyone who's doing these forms, mm-hmm. so that it's not subject to the abilities and inabilities of someone to track something down.
Right.
I can provide you guys with a website that lists all of the states alphabetically, and it gives all of the general marriage guidelines for those states. So, you know, age of marriage, when consent of parents are needed, things like that. So that it's consistent, because those things do change on occasion.
That's what I was just going to say, that changes.
That website is kept up to date.
Very good, thank you.
Okay. Also on the bottom, this one, the statement of the parish, that's if you can't get witnesses and you've known the family and the children, the child who's getting married, with uncertainty that you know for sure that that person's free to marry and so forth. That's very rarely used. I think in my years in the tribunal office, I've only seen that signed once. In the box, of course, that needs to be signed by a person in the chancery, either by the bishop, either by Father Ross, by myself as a delegate. That's if there's going to be a marriage take place outside of the Fairbanks diocese. You've got to get permission for our faithful person to be married outside into either it's Anchorage or if it's in New York, whatever. We have to have that signed. M3 is a witness. A lot of times that's used, and it's not mandatory if you have somebody, for example, it's in their 60s or 70s getting married. It's a good idea, but it's kind of understood. But yes, please fill it out, because most often it's a parent that does do this for their child that's getting married. So what I'm saying, and it's not mandatory, is like we don't hold up a marriage because of that. But we do ask that it do be done. Yeah, okay, that's it. There's also, there's only one copy in this packet, but you need more, like for a parent from each side or parents from each party to have that filled out. And then, of course, we come to the M4, which again, I said, is very important that we get that so that can be filed away. And it copies what you filled out on the back of the M1. And Bishop Kettler, when he was here for the prenuptial declaration of promise, it used to say optional signature by Catholic party. He wants it mandatory. He did. And I'm assuming, I don't know, I haven't met with Bishop Chad, that it should probably still be signed by the Catholic party, that they will raise their children Catholic. And then this dispensation is granted by, and that can be by the pastor. The bishop can always sign something. When in doubt, have the bishop do it. That makes sense? He's got authority to do that.
One thing that just dawned on me when you talked about the delegation, keep in mind that a few months ago the Holy Father changed some of the canons regarding marriage, particularly marriage between a Roman parishioner and someone from one of the Eastern churches. Deacons cannot licitly or validly witness a marriage now between a Latin Rite Catholic and someone from one of the Eastern Catholic churches. And that's to bring our code into conformity with the Eastern code, in which marriages have to be performed by a priest. So if you do encounter someone who is from one of the sui juris churches of the East, deacons cannot witness those marriages.
Okay. There was something I was just going to mention, and I forgot what it was. It was very important. I'm sure it'll come back. I have a note back here I want to make sure I say also. Okay, going to marriage preparation also. If you're preparing a couple and you feel uncomfortable with them, thinking, my gut's just telling me this doesn't seem right. I've done everything. They've done the prepare and enrich. They've done the engaged encounter. They've done everything that's required. I just don't feel comfortable that there's something that's not sitting with me well, and I have my doubts. Write a letter to the file, your marriage prep file, and insert that you have these concerns and doubts. Now, I know some priests that have just totally refused to say, I can't do it. I just don't feel right about it. And another priest has done that. at any rate, please write a letter to the file, because it's most probably going to happen that the marriage is not going to succeed. And if we go, they go to search for an annulment, at least one of the parties, that letter in that file is very important and very helpful in the process of looking for an annulment. So again, if you don't feel comfortable with the couple, or the one main reasons or concerns that really bother you, put that in writing and put it in the file. And again, just about the M4, please remember to send that to the Chancery, to my attention. Make a copy for your marriage prep file. And I have a whole bunch of these. If you want extras, pass those around. I have more back here.
Is there a spot for these forms on the diocesan website?
Yes. No, not on the website, but through me. The way they're set up, if you email me, I can copy and attach forms back to you, so they would be stored on your email addresses.
PDF forms that you can fill out and
yes.
print out, and it's a lot easier when you kind of notice a mistake to correct it and return it.
Thank you. Okay. I think you can do that online. You can fill them out, because I have not done it myself. I've just sent them out. Derek helped me do these. It took us, oh gosh, almost 2 weeks to do these forms because of the setup of it. But it can be attached to an email file, so you can travel and download it or do it right online with the couple. But I don't know that you can save it or not. Have you had?
Yes.
You can save it? Okay.
The first iteration you couldn't, now you can. And those who were newly ordained as deacons almost a year ago, I think, are current on the forms. Some of those in deacons who are going on their recollections from years past are using forms that are not the ones that you would like.
Okay. I've tried to get rid of those, and it doesn't seem to work by giving out binders that you could travel with or place in your file at the church. But to this day, things show up that I have never seen before, probably from the 80s. And so I don't know how to remedy that other than to keep asking, please throw out your old files, just keep the new ones, unless you have a better suggestion. Okay.
Not a licit suggestion.
Okay. I have here in my hand a Reader's Digest edition of Declaring a Marriage Null. I asked David to copy these for me, and they came out in the big form instead of the little form, because as you know, I've had it in the half size. So I've got a bunch of these.
Are these corrected from?
Yes, they are.
With those little glitches?
Right. Correct. As far as I know, I don't think there are any glitches. If you find one, let me know and I'll make another correction. Also, here's an application for a petition for an annulment. I have a bunch of these. I know some of you have stopped by the office and have run out. So please grab what you want, and I don't want to have to take any home. Do you have any questions?
Common law marriage, does that have to be, for it to be recognized by the state, does there have to be some sort of paperwork done, or is it just this person lived with this person for 7 years and they're married?
Well, I use the number 7 because that's in many states, but not necessarily all. I'm not real sure. Do you know the answer to that one either?
I've never run into common law.
Okay.
We don't have it up here in Alaska, so.
Right. I know, I think Idaho's one, Montana, yeah. Somewhere around in there.
Yeah, I've heard of it, but I didn't know if there was any legal forms that had to be filed.
I think it's probably taxes or something, or a recognition by the couple to say, yeah, we did.
Yeah.
We were living together for this amount of time, and we realized we were common law partners.
I would say when in doubt, call Barb, because that can invalidate a marriage. So we want to make sure that that's done correctly.
Okay. And as always, please feel free to call me. I'm happy to help. If I don't have the answer, I'll find it for you. And we'll make things right. Thank you for your time.
You.